Which did you like better, Jedi or The Empire Strikes Back?
Empire.
Blasphemy.
All Jedi had was a bunch of Muppets.
Boring conversation anyway.
Who need that? No, no, no! Alawa! Who need that?
Hey, Star Wars fans, and welcome to Boring Conversation Anyway. This is episode 145, and I'm your host, Chris. As always, I'm joined by my good friend, Thor. Thor, how you doing?
Good, very good.
And today we're doing a special edition episode for the month of April.
Yep.
Episode number 4 of the year-long special edition celebration. And today we're going to be talking about Jabba the Hutt.
Yeah, specifically Jabba the Hutt, the scene in A New Hope that gets added, which I think for me was like probably the thing I was most excited about as a kid. Just like, there's a whole new scene. Like, there's a whole new, like, a whole new scene. Like, it's not just things being added into it. Like, there's dialogue. There's, you know, it's
right.
Very exciting.
It's brand new. A scene that's completely cut.
Yeah.
And now it's added back in. So, yeah, it's cool. Now, you saw it at a much different time in your life than I saw it.
Yeah.
We'll get into that at the end of the show. But what we're going to do now is we're going to take a look at the scene the way it was before they added it back in. So when they decided to use a human actor because they knew they were going to sometime come back in and go over that actor with the creature, they shot it with a human actor standing.
Wait, they knew that then?
Yes. Yes.
What was like, what was the technology to do it then? Because
George talks about it a little bit. We got some audio for it, but basically, it was time and money. He wanted to mat over another creature for Jabba the Hutt, but he used a human stand-in.
Right. Okay. So that he was always going to be a stand-in.
Yes.
Okay.
He was never going to be Jabba the Hutt, and this is what George is saying. But either way, the scene was cut because they didn't have the time or the money. Now you could say, okay, well maybe that was going to be Jabba the Hutt, and just George didn't like it, or they were really going to go make a creature, and he just didn't have the time to finish it, and the money was getting tight for A New Hope.
You know what, though? Like, I like that it's in the movie. I like that it's still in the movie. You pull up on Disney Plus, that's great. But I think I've always maintained that it's much better left out of the movie. And there's a lot of reasons for that, one of which is, like, you get this kind of cool build-up to Jabba the Hutt if you've never seen it before. And then also, like, we just had a scene like this with Greedo.
Right.
We just had this scene. And also, there's, like, another Greedo that's in the background. And just
George,
little things, yeah.
Yeah, you just brought it up. I'll bring it up again, though, because George talks about that. And I, like, totally disagree about it. Definitely. Definitely. But, yeah. So, what we're going to do, though, is we're going to take the old black and white scene, and we're going to look at it, and we'll talk about it. So, let's pull that up right now.
Wait, why is it black and white? There's color in the 70s.
I lied. Okay.
All right.
So, what we're going to do now is we're going to look at the original scene. And this is with the human actor, and we're going to talk about him and everything else afterwards. But first, we'll play that scene so you can hear it.
Solo! Come out of there, Solo! Solo!
Right here, Jabba.
I've been waiting for you.
Have you not?
You didn't think I was going to run, did you?
Ah, my boy. There are times you disappoint me. Why haven't you paid me? And why did you have to fry poor Greedo like that? After all we've been through together.
Look, Jabba, next time you want to talk to me, come see me yourself. Don't send one of these twerps.
Han, understand. I just can't afford to make exceptions. Where would I be if every pilot we smuggle for me dropped this consignment at the first sign of an Imperial starship? It's not good business.
Look, Jabba, even I get boarded sometimes.
You think I had a choice? But I got a nice, easy charter now. I'll pay you back, plus a little extra. I just need a little more time.
Han, my boy, I'm only doing this because you're the best and because I need you. So for an extra 20%,
15,
I'll give
you... 15, Jabba, don't push it.
For an extra 15%, I'll give you a little extra time. But this is it. If you disappoint me again, I'll put a price in your head so big, you won't be able to go near a civilized system for the rest of your life.
Jabba, you're a wonderful human being.
What's kind of crazy with that, the actor Declan Mulholland, who's playing, or as you say, standing in for Jabba the Hutt.
Right.
He went on to like have a career.
He had a good career.
But that one scene that didn't even make the movie, and then when it did make the movie, he was removed from. But still, that one scene is the thing that probably got the most eyeballs on him.
Definitely. From, hands down.
You know, because it's wild to think about.
So he was born in 1932. He died in 1999. Belfast-born actor. Yeah, he had a long career. He had 50 credits, over 50 credits, and British television and between and movies between 62 and 97. But his, I gotta say, his biggest thing probably after this, which I still say is his biggest thing because you said he got the most eyeballs, he was in Time Bandits.
I was reading
that. With Kenny Baker and Jack Purvis, right? So other guys who were in Star Wars. And his costume is pretty much the same. So let's talk about the costume. He's wearing a shaggy fur coat kind of thing.
Yeah.
I think that could be some of the lead into to what a Gamorrean guard looks like, that they took that aesthetic from it. I really do.
Yeah, you know what? Right? Yeah, in a way. His body type, you know, helps too.
And yes, yes.
He's a husky fella.
And the other thing I would say is, did you notice that all the Greedos, I guess, or what do they call that character?
Rodians.
They're all wearing the same exact outfit.
Yeah.
Same exact outfit as Greedo. It's a little weird. So
It isn't. Because, if you're being presented it, it's just like, oh, it's an alien species of, bodyguards, and they all have a uniform. You know what I mean?
Okay.
It's just, and that still could be the case. There's nothing to say that couldn't be the case.
Right.
There's just something about seeing Greedo, and then Greedo becoming so much, his own thing that it's why are you dressed like Greedo?
Right,
why
exactly.
Are you dressed it's a costume. It's a uniform.
Also, they used what they had, because I think it's still in there. I know it was in there in the original. Greedo just gets killed, and then you watch a Greedo type walk around right after that in the streets of Mos Eisley. So
if they're wearing the exact same outfit, and obviously it's the exact same head,
right?
Then you're like, wait, can they come back to life? What am I missing about this alien species? And we're overthinking it, though. We're definitely overthinking it.
But it's really cool to see that. And then what we got to see is, that whole clip has to be put together. If you notice, there was the pitches were different, and the it was shot, not shot differently, but the grain was different because they had not released that scene complete for us. They released snippets, and people had to put it together. But we get all the dialogue, and that one really get it. It's cool. See, now there was a behind-the-scenes half-hour documentary called The Special Edition Trilogy. Talk about all three movies in a half hour.
Okay.
And yet they pull out, years later, they do The Anatomy of a Dewback, which is about 25 minutes.
Mm-hmm.
So you don't get a lot of information about the job of the Hutt. But we pieced it together, researched it. So we're going to go with some audio from George about why he wanted to do this.
Added the job of the Hutt scene with Han Solo, which was a scene that had been cut out due to time and money constraints. And once I finished the third film, I really wanted to go back and put that back in there because it was sort of relevant to what happens to Han Solo at the end of the movie. And I really wanted to be able to connect the first film with the third film the way it was meant to be.
All right, I didn't hear a word he said because I was too hung up on him saying Han Solo.
What? He does that all the time. Okay. Hoth and Hoth, he does that as well.
What? Okay, yes. Han I get, because in the movie is referred to as Han sometimes.
Right.
Hoth.
I think he does it to mess with people, but all right.
He does,
okay.
Man. He's...
This is where I disagree with him. You brought up the same thing. Okay. I go back and forth with this all the time. As someone who saw it older, in 97, I was 22 when this came out. I experienced Star Wars, which I think is the way you should, is that you go through A New Hope hearing about Jabba. You hear about a bounty hunter that comes after Han again in Empire Strikes Back. And then, oh my God, you finally meet Jabba in the third movie. The buildup is amazing. To me, this thing does two things. Now, again, being someone who saw it that way,
right?
I got to experience that.
Right.
So I don't care if you put it back in, because I saw it the way I wanted to see it the first time.
Right.
But that scene does two things that no one talks about the second part of it. The first is we see Jabba now, and it blows that out, right? So there's no suspense now to Jabba in the third movie. We see him. But it also kills the reveal of the Falcon.
Yeah.
Think about that. When Luke shows up, what a piece of junk. Well, we saw it already, so it doesn't matter.
I never think about it that way.
Right?
I never think about it that way, and that's so interesting.
And then again, what you said earlier in the episode, Greedo already lays all this out. We don't need anything else.
There's definitely a redundancy to it. that, strictly speaking from like a script point of view or story point of view, there's a redundancy to it. But also, the thing that always bothered me about it was that you meet Jabba in Jedi, and you've been hearing about him. Well, first of all, actually, let me before I even say that, here's something. We see Han essentially negotiate more time for himself with Jabba. So the pressure's off of him now.
Right.
Whereas in the original cut of Star Wars, that pressure is there. I've got to pay off Jabba the Hutt. And because time is a weird thing in Star Wars, it's like, yeah, well, you just talked to him yesterday. So, like, I'm sure you've got the weekend to help with the Death Star. But, and don't get me wrong, it's a cool scene. That's a good point, too. And it's great. But now the pressure's off. And beyond that, when we meet Jabba the Hutt in Return of the Jedi, he's pretty ruthless. Like, he doesn't fall for the Jedi mind trick. He throws his own dancer to the Rancor. A guard gets in there. Who cares? Let the guard get eaten, too. Like, he is absolutely... You know what I'm going to do? I'm just going to keep Han frozen in carbonite and hang him up on my wall. Like, he's just bad. He's just evil. And this Jabba, in all incarnations of it, so whether it be the version that you see or the one that they originally shot, the way that, what's his name, Mulholland?
Yes.
The way he delivered the lines, they're both... He's not that guy. He doesn't seem like somebody to be afraid of, no matter how many guns you have.
Yes,
and that's what I don't like, is I like the Jabba that's just ruthless. Like, you don't mess with him. And you certainly don't. I've brought this up a million times on the show. You do not step on his tail.
No.
That always, I know George loves it, but I always, well, probably not always. When I was 7, I probably didn't care, but it just makes him look... You wouldn't step on the Godfather's tail.
No, you wouldn't.
Scarface's tail.
Right, absolutely.
And that's the way I look at it. So I love the scene because it's just more Star Wars. It's Harrison Ford as Han Solo. But if I really think about it too much...
Yes.
Let me put it this way. I would rather show my kid like a good, high-quality original cut without that scene first. If we watched it in order.
Right.
And that's it.
And the end of the time, though, is kids now, which I experienced it with my own son... I showed him Star Wars when he was like 4 years old.
Right.
See, he saw it the way I wanted him to see it, but he doesn't remember seeing it that way. So, and at the end, it all kind of come at them at once, where we had the pacing, right? We had 77, 80, and 83. We paced it out. We dreamed about what was happening in between those movies and stuff like that. He gets to see them all in one weekend, and that's cool because he didn't see Jabba in the first one. He gets to see him in the third one, but he's 4. So what did he retain from that? You know what I'm saying? I'm sure... He remembers just Jabba in the scene of A New Hope now because of the special editions.
Yeah.
But it is what it is. So, but I get to say, okay, you know what? I got to see it the way we should see it. And quite frankly, I believe that's the way you should see it. Because one, it holds the Falcon for the big reveal. And two, Jabba the Hutt is not seen to the third movie. And you're absolutely right, which I didn't think about it, is that he's more of a gangster in the third movie. He's soft in that little scene there. I mean, it's not a major thing. He's letting the, you know, is you don't, but even the way he talks to his boys and stuff like that around him, he's all right, come on, let's go. It's nothing major. You know what I'm saying? So yeah. I get it. So let's jump into how they're going to do this now. Cause now George is saying what he wants to do, right? We know why he wants to do it now. This is kind what they're going to do. Kind of.
The scene was originally shot with an actor playing Jabba the Hutt to stand in for whatever creature we designed. Originally, I thought Jabba the Hutt would be kind of a furry character like Chewbacca. But as we went on and I redesigned him for Return of the Jedi, he obviously became a large slug and a very different kind of character. So we had to figure out a way of fitting that design into the original scene.
All right. Obviously. So they have to get this huge Jabba the Hutt over a man. No matter how big the man is, he still doesn't have a tail. And doesn't move the same way Jabba the Hutt moves, right? So
they got lucky though, because like he's about the right height.
Yeah, actually, yeah, pretty. He was a big guy, right?
And so also, you know what's funny to think about, and I don't know if you have the answers for this, and I don't, but like you're making Return of the Jedi. Does George have that scene in his mind anywhere? You know, if he's ever thinking like, well, someday I might, or not, because at that time, like there was no redoing movies, you know what I mean? This
right,
is 1983,
right.
So maybe he didn't have it at all of the idea of like, well, how would I later on put this job back into A New Hope? I don't know the answer to that. It's
so
fun to think about.
It's something that he hung up on because he definitely was one of the big, you know, we talked about the Dewback was a huge reason why he went and did, you know, the special editions because he wanted to be lifelike.
Right.
And this was another one. He really wanted to put this scene in there. So it meant a lot to him. People say it even slows the movie down because you're getting the same information twice.
And maybe there's value in that.
Yeah.
You know, I always felt like the Greedo scene, and I, again, this is another question I'm going to raise that I don't know the answer to, but like, was the Greedo scene written and shot to make up for not being able to use the Jabba scene, or did both scenes always exist that way? It's a little bit weird, but there are things that Han does that help, you know, well, shooting first or not shooting first, right? Like, there's character development that makes that scene valuable that you don't get with the Jabba scene. And then with the Jabba scene, the thing that you get a value, I mean, you see Han being like sort of like a smooth talker and I don't know.
Right.
There's different Han stuff. There's
some
stuff
there. Yeah. Yeah. And you get to see, you know, and there's some good Chewie stuff in there. You know, he doesn't do anything. You could see he's protective of Han in that scene.
No, you can't because everybody's too busy looking like, why does Jabba the Hutt look so weird?
Okay. So we're going to go to visual effects supervisor, Joseph Lettery. And he's going to talk about fitting in Jabba the Hutt.
The ultimate goal is to make it look like Jabba was on the set talking to Harrison Ford, and we just photographed it. The plan was for us to remove this actor and replace him with Jabba. He had to be physically in that space where this actor was.
Is that Shades?
No. Different guy.
It's just like him.
Yes,
though.
Yes.
Like a calmer version.
It's funny. Okay, he doesn't... Okay, He's not telling you how they're doing it computer-wise, but he's telling you what they expect. It's got to look like a shot. Now, we saw, like, you can't see that version anymore. That version was changed in 2004 for the DVD.
Right.
Watching that 97 version, does Jabba look like he's on the set?
It looks like something's on the set. I'll say that.
Right, okay.
I think it does look like Harrison Ford's talking to something. I mean, I think it's a matter of, like, well, how well did you create Jabba digitally? And that's something I'm sure
we're going to talk about that now. We had a superstar for Anatomy of the Dewback. Yeah. Now we have a superstar coming up right now for Jabba the Hutt. We're going to talk with, well, we're not going to talk. Well, I wish we could. But we're going to hear from Stephen Williams, better known as Spaz. How do we know this guy? This is the guy who did the T-Rex for Jurassic Park. Mm-hmm. And you guys, if you have not seen this, on Netflix, there's a series called The Movies That Made Us. I just watched it last night to prep for this. He's in there a lot. He has the greatest line I ever heard about working for Star Wars. He said, I got suspended 3 times from Lucasfilm, and I still put them on my resume.
Dude, yeah, that's good. I love those documentaries, but I hate the way that they're made.
Really? You don't like
this? Oh, my God. Because they have this narrator.
Yes.
That, like, glues the pieces together that's unnecessary.
Right. I see what you're saying.
The narrow will be like, and then Thor said, and then it'll be me saying something. But then Chris thought, and then it's you saying, it's like, who cares?
And this one, it's actually funny.
I can't watch him.
Because here's what happens in this one. So, you know who Dennis Muren is, right? From Star Wars, okay? And you know who Phil Tippett is. You know how much I love Phil Tippett. Well, Phil Tippett is going to do all the dinosaurs. Mm-hmm. They're not even thinking about doing computer dinosaurs at this time.
Yeah.
But a couple guys get together and they say, like, you know, we could do this. And Spaz is like, we're going to do this secretly. Because Dennis Muren said, we are not touching these dinosaurs. I mean, he's looking out for his boy. At this point, he's probably worked with Phil Tippett for almost 20 years with Star Wars, right? So Phil's doing the dinosaurs. We're not going to touch it. So what does this guy do?
Yeah, it's ironic that his story mirrors Grant's. Because he's like, too, like, there's no need for archaeologists anymore.
Yes. Well, that's he's the one who comes up with that line about being extinct when he found out.
Yeah.
And Phil's great in this, too. If you haven't seen this one, you should see this one, dude. It's awesome.
Right.
But real quick with this one, he's like, in his off time, he made the bones of the T-Rex. And it walked. And, like, I know Dennis hates me because he knows I'm committing political suicide in ILM by doing this. But he waits for Kathleen Kennedy to come in, and as she's walking by, he cues it up on his computer, and she does a dead stop when she sees it, and then gets Steven Spielberg. He sees it and is like, that's it. That's what we're doing. That's it. So that's the guy we're talking with. All right.
Yeah.
This is what he's doing. He did the T-Rex. He did the T-Rex in 91 and 92, and now this is like 95 that they're doing for 97, okay? So hear what he has to say.
This project here was about 5 shots, took about a year to do. We take the picture of some of the stuff we found. We use some of the off-the-shelf software to build a 3-dimensional wireframe mesh. Then the next process is actually paint the creature. And with the painting of the creature, it also involves the actual texture of the surface of the character.
I make fun of this all the time. Because he goes from doing a T-Rex to doing Jabba. But to be fair, the T-Rex is not sitting there and making facial things like a human. This is what Jabba's, they're making him do.
There's a lot of differences, too, is that you're going to footage that already exists and trying to make it work inside of that with their lighting and all and their angles and all that kind of stuff, whereas the T-Rex is open because you're making that then.
Right.
And so you got to come a break for that, I think.
Yes.
As well as, like, what you said about him having to be animated, having to, you know, he's delivering lines, he's walking around, he's acting like a human. But that being said, my biggest problem with Jabba, I always felt like there could have been, like, another layer to him. Like, he wasn't quite done yet. And this is in the 97 one. But the biggest problem is just they went way overboard with animating the face.
Yes.
Because you asked us to, and we did, buy into the puppet on Return of the Jedi. And this is an alien creature who can look like more stone-faced, and that's just part of his species. That's part of his thing. So when you go in, and obviously you want to take advantage of being able to sort of tell what he's thinking and expressing through his facial expressions, we just went way overboard. And that's something that they do fix in 2004, but, I mean, it's just, like, his eyes are just constantly going really wide.
And there's
like, two brows. And
there is that, you know, even without the facial things that you're talking about, there is that, like, you feel like one more layer of doing it was needed because it just looks unfinished. The eyes look unfinished. The skin looks unfinished. But we're also comparing it to today. And
no, like, we're comparing it to Tyrannosaurus Rex.
That is true, too. So I would say in 97, the thing that took me off of it was the eyes. Really freaked me out with the eyes. Because they look really watery, glassy, kind of weird. It's just weird eyes to me. And the skin wasn't as good as the dinosaur. So that's the thing you could say. Well, why was the dinosaur skin so good?
And that's the, I don't have an answer for that. Right. Other than just the harsh lighting. I mean, because I know.
Can I just give you something real quick? I understand that it's a different color than the dinosaur, but, you know, the Rontos that we see later on, we'll be doing an episode later on about, not just about them, but they're in there. Those were the Brachiosaurus from Jurassic Park. Right. He wanted to save money. He told the guys to use them, change the tail, change the head. And that's what they did.
Now that you think about it, like the way they jump up, it's just like how they jump up for the trees.
And
the...
no, that skin, if you put a Ronto next to Jabba from 97, they're made the same time.
Yeah.
Right?
It's tricky. I mean, obviously, we're not alone in thinking this, because they change it.
Right, of course.
In 2000.
And I think they're going to do it again eventually. They really do. Because it's been 20 years.
I would, if you could give me exactly the Jabba the Hutt that I see in Jedi, but in that scene, that'd be amazing. But if you can't do that, then don't bother.
I totally get it. I mean, I think with the last TV show, The Book of Boba Fett, I thought the Hutts looked really good in that.
I thought they looked good.
And I think we're going to get there. I really do. I think it's merging the puppet and the digital. It's like, if they could have scanned the puppet, which, you know, it's gone now. It's all rubber. It's all gone. But I think if they could have scanned the puppet back in the day, I think you'd be able to do it that way. Because, you know, like I said to you, I think the green is way too different. Like, if we've seen the green, we've looked at all the Jabbas, right? We looked at the 99 Jabba. We looked at the 97 Jabba. Now, 99 was for Phantom Menace and 2004. The green I thought was the best was in Phantom Menace.
Yeah, Phantom Menace is my favorite of the three.
Yeah.
The Phantom Menace Jabba. You know, what's interesting, though, is, like, if you said to me, Chris, what color is Jabba the Hutt? I'd be like kind of like a dark brown. And he's not, though.
No.
But why do I think that? And I think there's a lot of people that think that as well. And that just has a little bit to do with you see him so darkly in Jedi, and then every other time we see him, he's outside.
Really. I can tell you why I think it, too.
Yeah.
Because we see it in Jabba, it's lit so poorly because they were dealing with a massive puppet with, like, eight guys inside of it, right? So you can't...
And it fits the scene.
Right.
It works.
You can't sit there with the sun and you're inside a building. But 83 Jabba the Hutt is that one color. That one light brown, light yellowy brown color the whole way through. They don't put any green on it. Right. And that's probably what I was saying to you earlier today. It's like, where's the green? Why would you see these green on all these Jabbas? And then I'm watching the... We just went and looked at 83 Return of the Jedi, and it's there.
Yeah.
Is it hard to see? Yes, but it's there. It's just because it's not lit right. You know, I mean, it's lit right for them, but it's not lit for you to see all the details.
Definitely. Almost getting the color right, the hardest part about the Jabba the Hutt thing.
Yeah, I think so too.
Because when we look at the 2004 version, they've redone it. I think it's too dark, but they tone down the facial expressions big time. They nail that with getting that right.
I'll say one more thing about it.
Yeah.
What your mind plays tricks with you with.
Uh-huh.
Positioning of Jabba. We've seen Jabba one way in 83. laying on a bed, right? And now we got him moving, so his body's turned. Why do you think that? I think it's a big part of it. I think one of the reasons why we like the huts from Book of Boba Fett so much is they're laying down the way we saw them in Return of the Jedi.
Could be.
Right? I think it plays with your mind with that stuff, right? I think it does. So, okay. Spaz is on the job now.
Yep.
5 shots, 1 year to get him rolling. We got it going. Oh my God, there's a hiccup.
Mm-hmm.
What are we going to do? We're going to hear from the producer, Rick McKellum, on that.
We got to a certain point where everything was set, but there was one problem. Han Solo walks around Jabba.
What are we going to do?
Make Jabba turn with him, but obviously nobody thought about that in 1997.
Or maybe they couldn't do it in 97.
But the whole thing's animated. All you got to do is just make him rotate. Like, he doesn't need to do anything other than rotate like he's on a lazy Susan.
He walks completely in front of him and then behind him. Han is on the side when he's gesturing with his hand and then walks in front and walks around. I don't know how you would do that. You have to rotoscope the two of them out of that whole scene and then change it.
Wait, I'm having a hard time understanding it.
He's on Jabba's left side.
Right.
Talking to him.
He walks in
front. And he walks in front and then comes around, right? So how would you shift a thing like the size of Jabba? I'm trying to figure out how you would do, like...
Oh, the problem being, I think that you're trying to say is that because they're both kind of walking forward, how do we get Jabba to walk forward and at the same time do a 360 with his body?
With his tail, yeah. I think so.
I don't know, but I don't think it's possible. And also, you can't see those things in the shot anyways.
I'll say this. ILM has done it. Because I'm so bad with names right now, I apologize. But one of the guys, Hal Hickel. I got it. Yes. Mm-hmm. I love him. So, you know, a bunch of interviews and stuff. And I think I told you this. He asked his boss for a crack at Jabba. He said, like, we can get this to where we want it to be. And this is when George was still there.
Mm-hmm.
So he gets it exactly the way Jabba looks amazing, they say. But what he did was, I think he did what you said. He had them turn together so he doesn't step on the tail. And they show it in the film room to George. And Hal says, I've been there a while. I've never seen a mesh. Well, I saw a mesh. And he said that stepping on the tail was the best part.
Do you know what I always think about when I hear that story? Is, I don't know where the clip originates from, but there's a clip somewhere of George at Skywalker Ranch, and I think he's with, like, the Robot Chicken guys. And somebody asks him a clip, like, about, like, Mara Jade.
Yes!
And he loses his mind. It's a joke. He loses his mind and, like, throws him out.
He beats the dude up! He hits him!
I just imagine that, but happening for real.
So it was out. Now, I don't know why they didn't compromise and say, yeah, keep the skin and the eyes and everything that looks great and the facial expressions and stuff, but I still want him to walk on the tail. But it's like, no, so it's like his boss was like, we're just going to put that in the drawer for now. Don't worry about it. So, yeah. All right.
Interesting stuff.
So Spaz comes back to talk about how they're going to deal with the tail.
We had to somehow shift Han. It would have been literally impossible for him to walk behind the Jabba character because of the tail. So George had the idea, so why don't you have him step on his tail?
Even I get bored sometimes.
You hate that, as you brought up before.
I mean, I didn't get a chance, but like, I'm pretty sure they toned down Jabba's reaction in the 2004
one. Yes, you saw that right away,
It is, what, like, yeah.
And they fixed Han a bit. Because Han,
he just goes up and down.
It's like really awkward.
Jarringly weird.
Yeah, now it looks better. So, if they could do that, then they probably could have him turn, or whatever you were talking about, right? So, yeah, I think you're right there. So, yeah, that's what they had to do. They had to take Han, and they had to take Harrison Ford and raise him up. Bring him across because he's not physically doing that, and then drop him back down.
Yeah, it looked awkward in the original one, but I think they made it better.
Yeah. All right. And last but not least, we get Ben Burtt to figure out how he's going to do the sounds between his voice and him moving around because Jabba never moved around before.
Jabba the Hutt speaks Huttese, and that's a language that had been established in the original Star Wars by the bounty hunter Greedo. The sound of Jabba, of course, you have a computer-generated character. He's supposed to be a big, fat, ugly, slimy slug. A lot of the sound of him moving was just a lot of muddy towels in the bottom of a trash can. Stick your arms down in it and squish them, roll around in there, get some sound that way, and try to time it to the sound on the screen.
Baska. Good old Ben Burtt.
That's been such a fun job.
Oh, I was just going to say the same thing, right?
That's so cool.
He's done slimy noises before, but he's used his wife's macaroni.
That's right. Yes. Yeah, the original. Yeah. I remember that now.
Oh, so, yeah. So that's great, though. So we get the complete picture about how they did this. And you know, we got the why, somewhat the how, not in great detail like they did for the dewback. I mean, I'm still losing sleep about all the stuff they did in there to get those dewbacks on there. And the sound and everything else. And keep fast forwarding. In 2004, they touch it up or anything like that. They just keep making it better. Obviously, George sold the company, so I don't know if they'll ever do it again or not. But it probably could go around because the digital just keeps getting better and better, right? We're talking about that all the time.
Who knows? I really don't on that one. As far as like doing it again, it just feels like this. Like we don't want to touch that. Like,
listen, but
at the same time, you're already. Touched his movies in other ways.
A bunch of times, everywhere else, right? So that's another. Well, okay. Forget about it. If George still had it, do you think he would still be fixing them? Or do you think he was satisfied? Because that was his whole thing. He wasn't satisfied. So you think he's satisfied now and he wouldn't do it? I mean,
no,
I
guess. He definitely would be.
Because he did it 7 years later, right? So I think he would have. Now, that's another one. We're at 20-year anniversary coming up in May for Attack of the Clones. And of all three of the prequels, that's when it gets panned the most for the digital stuff because it's starting to really not age well.
Do you think
he would go back and do that?
I think definitely.
Yeah, I think
if
so too.
If he had the money, and why not? Yeah. Be like, you know, this looks jarringly different. That's the problem, is that because Phantom Menace was more like 50-50, it looks so much better.
Right.
I think they just got too confident. After Phantom Menace.
Yeah.
Just do the whole thing.
Yeah.
And it worked at the time, but it has aged poorly, in my opinion.
Yes.
Not terribly poorly. It's no, you know, Blade is pretty bad, but I keep
loving to kill Blade.
I only saw that movie once.
That's another special edition in the books, man. You have anything else you want to add?
Yeah, yeah, I do.
All right.
So Chris brought out his Jabba figures. Talking about Jabba Hutt figures. And I noticed that the one that was released from the special edition, which, you know, kind of walks when you twist his body, he's got four fingers. And then he brought out what his favorite job is, which is from when? When's that Jabba from?
This came out, like, in the 2000s.
Okay.
It was, I can't remember what series it came out, but it came out with the whole throne, basically, you know, and...
Yeah, he's got, like, a soft sort of rubber body.
Was it Ula? Yeah.
His really arms, cool. His elbows bend, which is pretty cool. But this Jabba has three fingers. So we were, like... Is that just an action figure mistake? So we went and we watched the original and we could see, okay, Jabba's got three fingers in it. And Jedi, how many fingers does he have in the special edition? And it's four. So they added a finger and I never knew that. And I've never heard anybody talk about that.
A great question is what we were doing all that. Did we check the 2004 one to see
how many fingers
he has?
Let's check.
Let's see.
Oh, you can't look from there. You got to find a...
We'll blow it up.
Right here, Jabba.
Four.
I think four.
Four. Okay. They kept the four.
So, like, am I just seeing the puppet wrong? I mean, this figure, it's three. Like,
no, the puppet is three. There's three. No doubt, the puppet is three.
A claw. So, it's just interesting. And it just, like, at some point that had to come up. That was not just, like, a mistake. At some point, they're like, George, what do you think about another finger? Or he was like, he needs another finger. There's no way you could be a gangster the level of Jabba the Hutt and not have four fingers.
You think it was just a mistake?
I have no idea. No, I don't know. You gotta, like...
Because if it was Disney, I would say it was a mistake. Just like the holsters.
That's true. Somebody sat down to do this, you know, this digitally, and they looked at, you know, all the references.
Not nuts. We looked at Return of the Jedi, and he has three.
Yeah. I don't know. That's very interesting. We might have to, maybe on my own, I'll try to research the fingers, and we can add it as, like, a, you know, on the next episode, I'll come back with what I found. It's just so weird, like, you're still finding out new things about these movies, and you've seen them how many times?
Dude, I mean, A New Hope is 40-plus years already, man, right? So it's like, it doesn't stop.
Special edition of New Hope is, you know.
20 years, that's what we're celebrating 20 years of it.
25.
Wow, God, 25.
You're thinking of Attack of the Clones.
That's right, yes.
So that's it, yeah.
All right, the dogs are getting restless, so let's get out of here. Guys, thanks so much for joining us. We'll see you next week. Please check us out on Twitter at Star Wars Cast and at Instagram at BCA Podcast. Email us at podcastbca@gmail.com. please leave us a review. It helps us out on Apple and on Spotify. And if you want to support us in a different way, check out some merch for us at TeePublic. Thor, say goodbye.
Goodbye, everybody.
All right, guys. Thanks so much. We'll see you next week. Go make some droids.